This is Ham Radio Now, as always, the most important amateur radio program on the internet. And this is our generic introduction to one of the 2017 ARL and Tapper Digital Communications Conference talks. The DCC was held in St. Louis in September 2017. Who knows what year it is when you're watching this? Okay, let's roll in the title. And you can see which one of the talks it is right down there in the title. If you're listening to the audio podcast, well, your app already gave you the title. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, and I produced and edited the DCC video series and stood there with the camera recording them all. And the only reason to record this introduction at all is to ask you for money. I didn't run a Kickstarter to support producing the DCC videos this year, and with travel, hotels, equipment, editing time, they get kind of expensive to produce. So I'm asking you to make a contribution to Ham Radio Now to pay me for doing them. It's pretty easy. Just go to the website, hamradionow.tv, do the click here to enter thing, and then when you get there, click the pig. That's Arvin, our chief financial officer and our mascot. And you get to our contribution page. And then you got three options. There is the Patreon, which sets up a monthly contribution. That's something that's good if you're generally supporting Ham Radio Now all year long. Maybe not if you want to do the Tapper Conference. If you want to just do a one-time contribution, then it would be this credit card. And you can click on the donate button. Or if you've got a PayPal account, it's also good for a one-time contribution. You can use a credit card in PayPal as well. And finally, the Kickstarters always offered a $150 level contribution, for which you got this little USB drive with all of the programs on it in high-definition video. So typically, well, last year was a 64 gigabyte USB 3 USB drive, so it was a pretty good high-quality one. Without the Kickstarter, there's still a way to do that. It's through the PayPal, and you just open that up and go down to this level, the $150 level, and get the DCC USB drive, and I'll see that you've ordered that or made a contribution for it, and when all the programs are done, then you'll get that. Back to the website for a second. Take a look up here at the top. If you want a link to all of the DCC videos going all the way back to 2008, we've got them here on the website. It's right under the episodes menu. Look down here and you'll see Tapper DCC. Let me bring that up to full screen. You see Tapper DCC. And if we switch on that, then there's several links. There's the DCC videos from 2011 to the present. Those are the ones that went straight to YouTube. There are DCC videos from 2008 and 2009, and those are the ones that we did on DVD back in the day when that was the thing. And I didn't do the DCC in 2010, but there are DVDs available, and this link will take you to them, and you can buy them directly from Tapper. So let me take a look at one of the YouTube playlists, and you can see what that looks like. This is just a simple, it was the easiest way for me to put together a list of things from the Tapper conferences. And you'll also notice that there's a few programs that are not necessarily DCC, but that I thought you might be interested in. There's the Tapper Banquets, Tapper Forums from Dayton, and like this program here, Carl Loffer's RTL SDR program. That was something we recorded from Dayton. It wasn't a Tapper talk, but something that I think you guys would be interested in. One last thing. Tapper and I would like these programs to reach every ham who might be interested in them, and that is harder than you might think. There's a lot of media out there, and it is all competing for your attention. So you can help by spreading the word to your friends in real life and in social media like Facebook and Twitter. In real life, you know, maybe mention them at a radio club meeting or on a net, or put a notice in your club newsletter. Just you get the word out as best you can. That would be a really, really helpful thing for you to do for us. And the best place to point people is to the hamradionow.tv website, or more specifically, to hamradionow.tv slash TAPR-DCC. And that'll get people there. All right, let's go to St. Louis and whichever Tapper Talk this is.
See if it'll actually work. It's amazing. I hate computers. No, I don't. 1, 2, 1, 2.
Let's see. We ready? It looks like a lot of folks must be going to the... Let's see here. Yeah, it's probably coffee.
They all ran out screaming when they saw my title.
All right. So we're a couple of minutes.
So we're going
to... You ready to get started?
Anytime.
Okay. All right. So let's go ahead and queue up our next speaker, Scotty Cowling, WA2DFI, on Internet Telegraph, outfitting the first digital mode with 21st century technology.
All right. Thanks, Steve. Thanks for letting me present here. It's great to be here and see a lot of the people that I see once a year. And after listening to Ward's talk, I find myself, it's kind of strange in a demented kind of way, looking with nostalgia back at the old days, in the 50s and early 60s of the Cold War. And you think, well, that's not very, I mean, why would you think of being threatened by A-bombs 24/7? That was fun, okay? That was a good time that we had. Well, you know, you kind of knew your enemy, you knew who it was. There was one bad guy, there was one good guy, which of course was us. And so at the risk of reviving the similar to Cold War battle that we had at Ham Radio, I'm going to talk about Morse code and kind of keeping it alive. And if you think that Morse code is dead, go listen to the band some weekend when there's a Morse code contest on. You will be astounded. There are more guys on there than there are during all the weekdays put together. So to illustrate some advantages of Morse code, this is a typical phone mobile installation. I found this on the internet, and you think this is bad, you should see the antennas, but we won't go there. Yeah. I especially like the cup holder here, down there, that holds about one third of the cup in the cup. I think the rest goes on the whatever radios underneath there. So now the typical CW operator setup is like this. I don't know who that skinny guy is, but from the past. So anyway, the idea is that, kind of like Ward said, go for it. If you're really into that, then go for it. But I'm kind of not into that, so I go for this more. But now the problem is, you got a dwindling set of CW operators, so how do we kind of fix that? How do we work on that? So a little bit of history. Before I do this, how many think Samuel F. B. Morse invented the code that we use today? Oh, good. At least there's a few people that are awake. Maybe you're all asleep because there's no hands went up. Anyway, so Morse invented American Morse, which is what they use on train-type telegraphs, sounders. And actually, this German guy here, I don't know how to pronounce that name, Gerke, he's the one that pretty much modified Morse's code to be usable on what we use today. I found it interesting that the German guys did a lot of really neat inventions on Morse code in the mid-1800s. They actually had a system where it was a wheel that would print out letters. It's kind of like a daisy wheel printer that they invented using Morse code as its input. I don't have any idea how it worked, but it sounds intriguing. Well, so not that much history. We don't want to go back to the 1800s. How about some more recent history? And these are the kind of milestones, I think, on the path of Morse code. This one's especially for you, Bruce. Right. But so you can see gradually over the past two decades, Morse code has kind of moved to the background as a specialty and just become another mode. And so now we can ask, well, okay, if it's just another mode, how do we get people interested and keep people interested? Because you can go down to HRO and you can buy an SSB transmitter and you can plug it onto your antenna and you can be making QSOs in 10 minutes. You don't need any particular skills. The skills you need on SSB are mostly you learn between the ages of 1 and 4. And if you listen on the bands, it sounds like not much past that. But anyway, so you don't need extra skills to operate your SSB radio other than the technical ones of how to tune it and how to hook the microphone up and things like that. But Morse code is different because you have to know how to operate the radio and make the code. Okay, so what do you do about it? Well, first thing, you got to be interested. If you're not interested in it, doesn't matter what you do, you're not going to have any results. So, and I kind of typed this, and before I really realized what I was typing, but okay, I'll take that pun anyway. If anybody get it, I don't. Anybody here was alive in 1915? No, never mind. Spark, you know, spark like spark transmitters? Okay, anyway, spark interest. You have to have interest. And there's two parts to the sparking the interest. You have to have the initial interest to be interested enough to want to do it, and then you have to have enough interest to sustain that effort, especially with Morse code, since it takes a while to learn, takes time and effort. And if you don't have enough interest, you're going to go 3 days into your practice sessions, you're going to say, oh, forget it, this is too hard, I'm not going to. So you got to find a way to make it fun during those learning phases where it's hard, but you got to keep it fun too. So one of the methods I want to use is to combine modern techniques like computers with old ones like Morse to capture the modern amateur's interest. Now, I'm an advisor for a local explorer post, a ham radio explorer post. If I bring 10 kids into a room and I have computers over here, and I have radios over here, none of them go over there. They're all at the computers. So that tells you kind of what they're going to be interested in. So you have to teach good techniques, and this is a pictorial of the proper technique for your key. Don't call it pounding brass for nothing, right? Anyway, so don't use junk, okay? You can go to Hamfest and you can find junky equipment. Don't do that, because it's like, I used to work on Volkswagens a lot, and John Muir wrote an excellent book on how to keep your Volkswagen alive for the complete idiot. And it was basically how to use common techniques and innovative techniques that you could do, that not as a professional mechanic, to keep your car alive. And one of the things he said was he bought the most expensive and best tools that he could buy, because when he was taking that muffler off and the stud broke off and he banged his knuckles against the side of the engine and he was bleeding all over and he was mad, and he said he would go clean his tools. He would handle his tools, and that made him feel better. So whether that will make you feel better, I don't know, but it worked for him. And besides, you know, plastic keys are horrible. Do use modern techniques. I mean, just because it's a mode invented 100 years ago doesn't mean we have to stay in the 100 years ago mode, okay? Modern things like Farnsworth spacing is really useful. And practice, and I think a lot of instructors make this mistake. Don't just say, okay, I taught you everything now. There you are. Have fun. And then you go off to your 30 word a minute buddies on 40 and you leave them stuck where? With their CPO, you know, trying to practice to talk to themselves. So practice with them, get involved with them, and that helps. It helps a lot. Oh, and I forgot, make it fun. So this is the biggest problem I see right now, is you get people who are interested, and in our Explorer post, we have half a dozen people who are interested in learning code. Some of them have learned most, if not all, of the letters. They get up to 3 words a minute, 5 words a minute, then where do they go? They go on the air. Maybe they go on the air. And then all they hear is 20, 30, just blazing fast code. They can't even understand it. In case you haven't noticed, the areas on the bands where there are beginning CW ops are shrinking down, and there's not a lot of activity at real low speeds. I know NAQCC is a great example of a solution to this. In their monthly sprints, 2 hours long, so they don't take up your whole weekend or your whole week, they're actually on Tuesday and Wednesday nights, they have double points for using a straight key. And you say, well, okay, that's cool, but so what? Well, so what? The speeds now go down to 10 to 15 words a minute, not this 30 words a minute machine gun. So it's great for beginners, place for them to go once they learn the code and then don't have anyone to really to talk to. So you have solo sessions become boring. I mean, how many of you learn code with tapes? How many of you learn code? Oh, never. But it gets boring after a while. Listening to canned stuff, and believe it or not, even if you have 20 tapes, I guarantee you if you listen to them going to work, which we all did maybe, you learn them. You learn them up here, even though you don't really think that you learn them, you anticipate what's coming next, so then you get less out of it because it's anticipated. So difficulty in finding partners to talk to, and beginners, this is a big one, beginners usually don't have radios, or they don't have antennas, or they have minimal radios and antennas that they can't really talk to anyone very decently with. I mean, it's, you have a dipole in the attic, you have an HOA doesn't let you put up an antenna, what do? You're back to your code practice oscillator. But almost everyone has a PC with the internet connection now, right? I mean, most tech people do. Okay, anybody here not have internet at their house? Okay, see, there you go. So, one of the things we did, and this is in 2005, so this is 12 years ago, we wanted to find out how we could get kids interested in Morse code. And actually, it didn't start out as being about Morse code. It started out being just getting them interested in radio, in ham radio. So what we came up with was and I should probably just put all these up here. I think I got one more, yeah. So what we came up with was, these are the criteria, I should say. We got to be able to build 100 cheap because we want to give them away. And we don't have a very big treasury. And it's got to be easy enough so that a 10-year-old, a non-ham with no soldering skills and no technical ability can build it in 10 minutes. Well, it's pretty restrictive, right? This is a big one here. Quiet enough so that your mom would allow it in the house because, you know, the last thing you want is mom throwing you out. Yeah?
But Scotty, if your parents hate it, that makes it more.
Yeah. Well, that's true for 14. He says if your parents hate it, that makes it more attractive, right? That's probably true for about 13 or 14 on. But at 10 years old, maybe not so much. Because what will happen is it will just disappear. Like my brother, his kids when they were little, they decided they liked rap music. And so they would go on Napster and they'd download all this rap music on the PC and they'd play it and it was just awful. So I asked my brother, how do you deal with this? And he says, well, you know, every once in a while, it all just disappears off the computer. We just don't know why. Yes?
Router rules.
Pardon me?
Router rules.
Router rules?
That's how you make Napster disappear.
Okay. But he doesn't want to make his kids mad, okay, by taking their toy away, but he just kind of controls it. It's regulation. Okay, so fun to play with so that you'll want one. This is the key. You got to want one. Otherwise, if you don't want one, nothing's going to fix that. And preferably something to do with ham radio, since we are a ham radio explorer post. So we came up with this idea here. It's called a free CPO, and you might think that this looks a little bit familiar. This shape came right out of the Now You're Talking book from ARRL. However, all of our explorers didn't like the idea of like just a resistor, through-hole resistors. They wanted to do SMT. They wanted to do the state-of-the-art. So we redesigned it with all SMT, and you see this buzzer here? Well, that came about because some guy at a ham fest donated 500 of them to the Explorer Post in a bag. So we said, okay, well, we got to find something to do with them. So, and it was designed to be cheap because you see the battery? The battery is the spacer. We designed the board SMT, nothing on the back, so the battery won't short anything out. We used 4 screws to hold it down against the board with the battery as the spacer. Another guy at HamFest gave us a huge bag of these 9-volt clips. So a lot of those parts were free. This here is a woodworker's hole plug. Have you ever seen those? And what you can't see under here is there's a screw, wood screw, that screws in here, and there's a wire that runs up, and it solders right in there. So cost to build, $1.50. This is after we scrounge, and like, for instance, my CAD guy that I worked with for 25 years, he offered to lay the board out for nothing.
Including the battery?
The battery was the worst part that we had, but our scout leader went around at the ham fest and he got one of the vendors to agree to sell him batteries for, I think, 25 cents, which is, that's about one third the cheapest we could find on eBay or anywhere. And you find, you go to eBay and you find it for 69 cents. Oh yeah, plus $20 shipping. So it's not, doesn't work. So the battery was the hardest part to procure, but it ended up being $1.50. My company donated all the parts. Like I said, we got the clip and the buzzer for free. The other parts were Home Depot, you know, screws and the hole plug and things like that. So we built 100 of them, and we gave 98 of them away. And now you ask, well, okay, how is the Scout going to build this? Okay, well, we built all the service mount. And so what the Scout had to do was he had to solder the two wires from the battery onto the board, two through-hole wires, and he had to screw in the screw down here, and you have to put the wire in the screw hole. We pre-drilled the board to put the wire in the screw hole and screw the screw in, so because it's the lower contact, and there's a contact on the PCB that runs up here that is the second contact. So a screw head is the contact for the key. So it did take them a kid that knows nothing about soldering. We could teach him how to solder, and we could get him to do it in about 10 minutes. So the result was, this is our school bus with the, I think this is better than some people's home setups for working that we had in the back of our school bus. And what we would do is we would build or test the SMT boards in the back while the kids were building them outside. Or if they had trouble, they couldn't get theirs to work, they could come inside and our scouts would help them. And no scouts were harmed. This boy here is his son, so. And notice how he's paying attention to dad here. So, how did it work? It worked great. We had lots of young kids, because Scout-O-Rama is up really through 18, but mostly it was 14 and under kids that we had. And they really appreciate this. And I like the keying technique here. This is another one along the line of pounding brass. And we had a line out of our booth for the first time since I've been doing this the entire day. In fact, we had one adult sneak in and somehow build one of these, and I don't know how they got through the line, but it was supposed to be for kids, because the deal is you can't take the kit home unless you build it. So we're not giving out bags of parts. If you want to take it home, you got to solder it up and show us it works before you get to take it home. So, I'm getting ahead of myself here. So that was 2005. Now you move up to 2008, and we came up with this idea. It kind of came out of QST, because we had the surface mount CPO, and there was an article in QST, and I think it's up here. Oh, I didn't put it in. Okay. There's an article in QST on how to hook your HT up to a CPO and transmit on the air, so you could practice on 2 meters on the repeater. And right about this time, the 2 meter repeater activity was kind of going down into the tank, and all the repeaters were empty all the time. So what a better use for it than to practice code. So we built this one, which is a combination of the previous one, CPO, and we added a few things like a switch for TR keying. And it was designed to work with either ICOM Kenward or Yaesu HTs, which most people had at the time. Oops, wrong way. So this is the second model. This is a prototype here in an expensive box. This is the El Cheapo model in a plastic box. And you notice it's Mark III. There was a Mark II, which was really kind of haywire all over the place, so we couldn't really produce that. So here's the whole setup here with key, code key. And you know what happens? This is the hardest part, finding keys now. I can build all this electronics for nickels. But to find a key, you go to the ham fest, oh, that's an antique, $50, you know, and it's like, I don't want to pay $50 for the key. So what I do is whenever I find them for $10 or less, I buy them. And I'll show you in a minute how this really paid off, even though it makes my shack look bad. But so this is the combination. Again, it's all SMT. It's a 550, CMOS 555, a FET driver, and this is the ICOM keying circuit. Basically, you switch a resistor in across the microphone, and that keys the transmitter. And the beauty of it is you don't disconnect the microphone and the radio, so if you're on, all of you are on the air, you could say, okay, now I'm going to send paragraph 3 on page 20 of QST, and then you put it down, and then you flip the switch, and then you start sending. So you can talk and do code at the same time. And this is what it looks like. The guy with the mean guy with the soldering iron, he and his son laid this board out with Microsoft Word. All you can see all it is straight lines, right? And he etched it in their bathtub using, hey, you know, I'm not going to argue. He brings me a stack of boards, and they're all, these are all the components, the red guys here. This is the 555. The FET is right here, and it's all just SMT resistors. The kids love SMT because of course they can see them. But so there's a finished one right here. This thing here, this giant thing here, that is a toggle switch, the transmit-receive switch. And notice that the board is supported entirely by the toggle switch, so the box consists of, modifications of one hole, and then the switch holds everything, and then a couple holes for the wires to come out. So that said, that's kind of the background behind where we're going. Now you say, well, that was 2008. That was almost 10 years ago. So what do we do for an encore? Well, again, like I said, I want to combine modern techniques with old techniques. I want to produce, all these bullet items are really necessary. Group practice, virtual room, it's kind of like being on the air, but if you're a newbie, you don't have a radio, you don't have a license, how do you get on the air? You can't. So we provide a way to do it with a virtual radio called the internet. Got to be inexpensive. Even if you have no junk box stash, and most of the people have so much stuff that this is more like $10 instead of $40, and I'll get to the key is the important thing. It requires some assembly because you don't want to just say, go buy it on eBay. This is hands-on. You got to solder something. You got to bolt something together. So I'd like to claim that I conceived this idea, but I didn't. We actually, one of our explorers found it on the internet. Anybody know what Makezine is? Yep. Well, this is a Makezine article written by three brothers that live in Vancouver, and it uses a Raspberry Pi Zero W, which is, you know what, everybody knows what a Raspberry Pi is. You know what a Zero is? Yep. Little bitty cheap. Well, Zero W is the Zero with Wi-Fi. And it raises the price to $10, which isn't going to break the bank. You need a buzzer to make sound, and you need a key. And this is the key. I managed to outfit half a dozen of our hams, our prospective CW hams, with keys out of my collection. And the deal was, you get the key for it's. Who was it? Yesterday was talked about the perpetual loan. It was you. I said, when you're done with the key, only I modified it a little bit. I said, just when you're done with the key, it either comes back to me, or you give it to someone who will use it. You can't charge for it. You got to give it to someone who will use it. So they all thought that was all right. Connects to most any access point, and it can run headless, so you don't need a monitor or a keyboard. Once it's set up, you don't need a monitor or keyboard. And the chat room is defined by a string, so there's an unlimited number of them. It runs in full duplex, and you configure it by plugging a monitor and a keyboard onto it, or you can SSH into it, and you can make some modifications remotely if you don't have a keyboard and monitor. And suggestion that we made that they didn't have, it when it can't find the internet, it just sits there like a rock, which is less than useful. But you have a buzzer, and you have a key, and you have a microprocessor, so I suggested when you can't find the internet, how about you go into local mode and just make it be a CPO. So they like that. So the next release, they're going to incorporate that into the code. And the code's all open source, so if we were really proactive, we could go fix it ourselves. It's in Prolang, I think. So this is what it looks like, and you can immediately see that there is a slight problem, which is this button right here. Although I do like the wood box and the engraved Morse code in the top. That's pretty cool. But the button's got to go, okay? And so it's Adam, Isa, and Emmanuel McKenty, and I've actually been exchanging email with Adam. They're talking to us about features and things, so it's great fun. Again, Makerspace is cool. You find lots of interesting people there. So here's the Pi Zero with this massive subset of features. The boot code's on the SD card. Like I said, you don't need to use a monitor, HDMI monitor, or a keyboard. Keyboard's here. just need power. And then you do need the I.O. here, which it does not come with. So hence the soldering aspect. You have to solder something on, a 20-pin, a 40-pin header. Not too hard. Even first-time solderers did pretty well. So here's what you have to do to make it. Solder the header on. You got to make a pigtail for the going to the key so you can get it to the header. You have to make a buzzer pigtail going from the buzzer to the header. You have to clean up and mount the telegraph key. And the reason I put clean up here is because the telegraph keys I gave to the kids were all pretty grody looking because they come out of people's junk boxes. I said, okay, here, here's some Scotch-Brite, here's some Brasso. Disassemble your key and clean it. This is a good practice to learn how your key works. So they all did that. We have to program the micro SD card image, assemble it into a case if you don't have to, but we had cases. And you have to update the parameter so it'll connect to your access point, your network. And if you eventually we're going to have our own server and our own chat room, but right now we connect to the server in Vancouver. And we change the chat room name to Post 599, which is our Explorer Post number. So if you build one of these and connect there, you can talk to us if anybody's on. And we configure it for DHCP. So those are the steps you have to do to actually assemble the unit. So there's this is a couple of the intermediate steps, soldering on the 40-pin header, soldering the buzzer onto the wire headers. And this is their wooden case here, and their massively overrated push button, and the buzzer here, and the code's on the opposite side of this lid. So this is the actual schematic of it. It's not really very complicated. We ended up in stock in my junk box. I found a big bag of 2-pin headers, so that helped people hook them up. And we basically bought the Pi Zero and the cards, the SD cards and the power supplies. And then, of course, the telegraph keys. I have, okay. So again, pretty simple. However, what we discovered when we built the first one, and we kind of got excited on this, and we went out and bought, we went out on our mailing list, and we said, okay, who wants to do Morse code? Who wants to do a Raspberry Pi? Of course, the Pi attracted half of them, and the Morse code attracted the other half. We got 16 people that wanted them. And the kits were $29 on eBay. You could buy them with the case and the power supply and the adapters and everything. Well, that's $550 or something that went on my Visa card. And I'm going like, am I going to see these 16 people and get my money back? Well, that was no problem. They all were interested. But this was the preferred, I mean, they told us in the article that this buzzer would work here. It turns out they have a slight problem in that this buzzer is a 5-volt buzzer. This I.O. pin is a 3.3-volt I.O. pin. And if you go try to find info on Raspberry Pi I.O.s, you can't find the data sheet for the processor. You can't find, the data sheet says input, output, programmable. That's it. That's your spec. So it's really hard to find the data. I finally did find the data sheet for the processor, which the processor is connected directly to the I.O. pin. And it's 16 milliamps at 3.3 volts if you program it to the high drive output, which nobody knows what drive they programmed to, but I can tell you what, it wasn't the high drive output. So we hook the thing up and we get it on the air and we press the key and it goes and if you hold it up next to your ear, you could hear it, but not really usable, right? So I wrote back to Adam and I said, hey, you know, what's the deal with this? And he says, well, we built three of them and they worked fine. Well, if you, creating a tone, if you bang it on the desk, then you get a tone. But then as soon as you unkey, when you key down again, you get the weak tone. So anyway, to fix this problem, we decided we're not going to mess around with trying to find another buzzer. We already bought them. We already built them. So this is Explorer Post, right? And we've got technical people, right? So let's build a solution to it. So the solution was, and I'm going to get into that, was a MOSFET driver. Okay, and we used the tried and true technique of straight line PC board etching with a Dremel tool. This board here is 3/4 of an inch. You can see it's underneath heat shrink right here. I didn't have the heart to peel the heat shrink off to show you what the board looked like. But it basically solders right onto the buzzer and you get three wires of solder onto the other side. You got one part. And that's the schematic. It's so this goes to 5 volts, the proper voltage. This is your 3-volt I.O., which drives the gate. And then, I mean, this is how more dirt simple than that can you get? So we're going to send this back to the McKenty brothers, and they're going to include it in their article update. So, because now I tell you what, you go in the room. I got one a demo in there. You don't want to listen to it very long. It's really loud. So we have the adjustable volume control as a piece of tape over the hole, and then you put a pin through it, and you make the hole bigger if you want more volume. It's a little hard to turn the volume back down once you've done that, but tape's cheap, so you just do that. Anyway, so back up to here. One of the other improvements we made, well, other than getting rid of the big red button, they originally had it so that when you press the key, it sent the data to the server, and then the server sends the data out to all connected devices in that chat room. Well, this is kind of like talking on the satellite. You know, 300 millisecond delay, it's like, okay, 2 words a minute works great, but anything above 10 words a minute, it was almost impossible to send because the feedback was just not right. It would mess your ear up. So I went back and suggested that they do a local loopback, and they fixed it. So they changed the software so that when you press the key, it's instant. Now, it's not quite instant. I think they need a little help still, but I can send with a key or at 20 words a minute, and you can do it. It's not bad. And the second one here, we talked about that a little earlier, code practice mode when it can't find the access point. They thought that was a great idea, and they're going to put that in also. And it's interesting, the result of this local loopback is that the local echo is at a different time than the remote signal comes back from the other one. So when we hooked up 3 or 4 of them in the same room, when you key one, you get instant feedback, and then about 200 milliseconds later, the other ones go off. So you got to keep them away from you, otherwise you have the same confusion problem. But of course, normally you would not have 2 in the same room, so it's okay. And so now, of course, since we don't have voice like we had on 2 meters, now you have to use proper prosigns, you have to call CQ, you have to use K and AR, you have to do it right, otherwise nobody, it'll be mayhem because everybody will be trying to transmit at the same time. Okay, so let's see, where am I? Okay, so this is the updated version. Fortunately, 5 volts is available on the I.O. header, so we just ran a pigtail over there. And this is our little board with the buzzer hanging off of it, hooked to the same 2 drive pins, same key, say everything else is the same. And now you've got ear-splitting sound, S9 plus 40 over. So this is a setup right here. I've got one of these in the other room for you to pound brass on. And I've asked some of the other explorers to turn their keys on, so maybe we'll be able to work someone. But unfortunately, it's during the day, and Friday, yesterday, not likely, because the school's in session. And today it's a Saturday, so be rough getting someone to come on, but we may hear someone. So if you're interested, oh, I'm getting ahead of myself. So how do you make it work on your own system? I showed all the hardware. Well, if you edit this file here, which looks like this, you put in your own SSID and your password, and if you're using PSK, I think it supports WPA and WPA2, probably not WEP, but a couple kinds of encryption, of security. So you just edit that file. And by the way, it's interesting, in the network, in here you can add multiple sections. So you can add your home AP and the work AP and the Starbucks AP and the McDonald's AP. And a lot of the guys brought in cell phone charging batteries and they plug it on, and now they've got a portable unit that they can carry around anywhere they want. And as long as they're within range of an access point, they're on the air, they're in the chat room. So it goes back to Ward's comment about, well, where are you going to use it? Well, maybe anywhere, because you can carry it anywhere you want. Also, if you decide you want to change the channel, this is the chat room name, and this is where you put post 599 in here. This is the server up in Vancouver, and it uses port 8000, so of course you have to configure your router to pass port 8000 for it to work. And most of all, have fun, get on and play. And I think I'm a little, am I a little early, Steve? Well, I'm done. So, questions? Oh, the URL?
One more back.
This one? That one?
And then we'll go to the next one.
Okay. Okay, right here. You want to get the mic over there? Oh, sorry. Right here first?
Yeah, Paul, KA5FP. Oh, am I? Okay. Just curious, how active is the Morris chat room?
Well, it's
set up if you have people regularly.
Well, since it's your own chat room and everybody has their own, I haven't connected to the default. What is it? Did you get this down already? To the lobby? This one here, this channel here? This lobby channel, that would be the default because everybody who read the article would connect there. Well, we opted to not do that, and we used our own instead. So basically, it's only going to have the people in it that are in our group. So I'm not sure what the answer is. And you're kind of asking how many people built these, right? And I think that would be a great answer to have. So we might try doing this and just see how active it is. Oops, back up. Ward.
There are a number of 3D print key files circulating out there, and if you want to get into a group that's already sort of into the maker thing, and one of them has a 3D printer, you can 3D print yourself an actually reasonable key, and I think use some screws through the key to make the various contacts and that sort of stuff, just wood screws to hold it down.
So it's printed out of plastic, though, right? Or fiberglass?
Oh, yeah. It's ABS, right. You know, and also there's some CNC files out there to actually, you know, machine parts to build a key as well. So if you want to get into that, you know, interface to that community, I realize this is a kind of a scout minimalist thing,
yeah.
But if you've got the door open into a maker group, there are straight keys out there, and I built one out of a piece of, you know, scrap lumber and a busted hacksaw blade, you know, and it's a really fine
but
iambic
paddle.
We
already got them saying that they want to go to paddles and electronic keys, and I'm going like, no, you're not, until you learn how to send code properly with a straight key.
You
now
must,
that might be two weeks or 2 days, but you're going to learn how to do that. Otherwise,
you must suffer.
You must suffer. I suffered, so you have to suffer too. Okay.
First.
Okay.
Just curious, did the 599 post number come automatic, or did you have to get it?
That was not an accident, as was our W7BSA club call sign was not an accident. And apparently there is another scout group in Phoenix who tried to get W7BSA, and our advisor is faster than his advisor, so we got the call sign. So, yeah, it's that for a reason. And actually, interestingly enough, Explorer Post call signs are 4 digits. They're the identifying number is 4 digits. So if you look at my ID card, it says Post 2599, but all of our documentation, shirts, everything say Post 599. So, okay. Bruce, oh, I'm going to ready to take fire here now.
So, Scotty, I think it would solve a lot of the world's problems if before people got on the internet, they had to pass a code test.
So is that C or is that assembly,
right.
That code test?
And but seriously, I would encourage you, and I can actually show you how, to use libwebsockets instead of port 8000, because once you do, it goes over the HTTP socket, and all of the routers are already open to that.
I think I remember them saying that they do use websockets, but could they do that over port 8000 also?
They could do it over port 8000 as well, but the point is, as long as you have one server where you can open the web,
and then
the
you wouldn't have to change. You would have to change anything in your AP.
You would be able to go anywhere and connect to any access point without modifying it. The other nice thing about it is that it connects really well to JavaScript and web browsers, so you can open up a web page which connects you to the server.
Okay. Well, thanks. I'll talk to you after. Oh, Tom.
Those of you that are old enough to remember Popular Electronics magazine from the late 50s, early 60s, probably remember the Carl and Jerry stories. And one of the ones they had in there where they had built a couple of QRP transmitters and they sat on the opposite side of class sending Morse code to each other. And I'm thinking there's some room for abuse here, too.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was amused by your early talk about Morse and history. And if you get a chance, there's a book a couple years old now that I read about Morse. And Morse was actually a very fascinating guy. First of all, he fancied himself as an artist, but he finished second in the contest to paint the inside of the Capitol building down in Washington. He finished second. Obviously, he didn't get it. His invention was actually a machine that made marks as it rotated back and forth in a pendulum, okay? And this marks then were used in conjunction with a book, a so-called book code. And that's how the first actual Morse code was done by him. And he fought viciously to protect his patent for that machine. A lot of people don't know any of this, okay? The other thing is, he also was one of the people who sponsored one of the first undersea cables to go over to Europe. And what's interesting about that is they worked very hard, and they sent boats from both sides of the Atlantic, and they met in the middle, and they hooked up together, and it worked for 2 weeks. And then it died. So the second time around, he did better. And he also started an art class in New York City and all kinds of interesting stuff. So if you get a chance if you're interested in history, you might want to look him up.
Well, one of the things that we did in the class where we were building these, it's kind of, we took a little bit of a break in between all the soldering, and on the MakerZine site, there's a link to a U.S. Navy video from 1943 of the proper way to learn and operate a telegraph key. And everybody watched this. It's about 11 minutes long or something like that. But the thing I got most out of that was, and this is the thing I harp about to my explore posts, especially on field day, clean your desk off. So I thought it was great. In this video, they have clean your desk off, first thing you do, because it will never get cleaner than it is when you sit down. So get the clutter out of the way to enable you to concentrate.
Okay, we can take one more question. We got to quit.
Yeah, Scotty, I was just curious if you were aware, you made reference to the Morse Telegraph Club earlier in your presentation. Have you seen what they do with their system called Morse KOB?
Yes, and that's another, it's basically the analog of this, only using sounders. And we wanted to use International Morse because our guys are, they want to get on the air eventually. The motivation behind this, by the way, is all entirely due to field day. Because they see 2-point bonuses for CW contacts on field day, and they want to beat the local club. They're very competitive, and they want to build their speed up enough so that they can actually make QSOs on CW on field day. So that's why we kind of went this way when we saw this article.
But yeah, yes. Their system is, they have a server, and it's well refined. It works great.
And they have like 100 chat rooms you could pick from, and they have assigned ones for certain things, right?
But aren't they American Morse?
They are American Morse.
Well, it's Morse code. it's the real Morse code. But anyway, they've been doing this successfully for almost 10 years, so it's a great idea, and it works well.
Okay, thank you very much. It's an interesting topic, Scotty.
All right, thank you.
So we have Dave Witten. We'll set up here. Not related to Mel Witten. Twin brothers from different mothers. Name that group.
Kim Weisberg.
So while we're on quiz, so the smoker you drink, the player you get is? Who is, what's his ham call sign?
WB6ACU.
There you go.
My name
money for
nothing. See, look at all this useless knowledge we have here.
Up and down.
And there's the bomber.
That's it. Let's put together a ham radio trivial pursuit. All right, David, you ready?
Yeah.